In this module, we're going to talk about precipitation, KSPs, and something called the ion product, Q. Now, Q, it's just like we've seen Q before, the reaction quotient in equilibrium, and it's the same thing. So what we can use Q for is to predict whether or not a salt will precipitate out or not when we mix two solutions together that potentially form an insoluble salt. So Q is just like KSP, except that instead of the equilibrium concentrations, we have the initial concentrations of the ions. And so this is a good thing to remember right down here. We're going to calculate Q, and I'll show you how. And when you calculate Q, if the value you get is less than the KSP for that salt, then when you mix those solutions together, no precipitation occurs. We don't have enough ions in solution to precipitate the solid. But if Q is bigger than KSP, then yeah, we get precipitation and it keeps on precipitating until we get to the point where Q is equal to KSP. So let's look at an example. Suppose we take two beakers. In one beaker, we have 840 milliliters of 3.14 times 10 to the minus 3 molar cerium-3 nitrate. And we have another beaker, we have about 327 milliliters of 2.09 times 10 to the minus 2 molar potassium iodate. And we mix them together. We want to know, first of all, we want to know, will any cerium-3 iodate precipitate out? And this is the KSP for cerium-3 iodate. So first thing we have to do, okay, our goal initially is to calculate Q, and for Q we need the concentrations of their molarities. Because we're adding 840 milliliters and 327 milliliters together, we're diluting both of these solutions. So we have to use the dilution equation to calculate our initial concentrations so that we can plug into Q. So for the cerium-3 nitrate, take the M1 times V1 over V2, and that gives us M2, which is this number right here. Same thing for potassium iodate, M1, V1 over V2. This 1167 down here, that's just 840 plus 327. And so we get these initial concentrations. Now, for this equilibrium, there's a KSP. We plug into Q, looks just like KSP, except it's not the equilibrium concentrations. This is our initial concentration of cerium-3. Oh, by the way, I talked about cerium-3 nitrate and potassium iodate over here. The nitrate here and the potassium iodate here, the potassium here, they're just carrier ions. These salts are completely soluble. Once you put them into solution, the nitrate is a spectator ion. Doesn't do anything more. Potassium doesn't do anything more. It's really the cerium that we're putting in here and the iodate. And because there's one cerium in one cerium-3 nitrate, the concentration of the cerium-3 nitrate is equal to the concentration of the cerium-3. Likewise with the potassium and the potassium iodate. We plug those numbers into Q, we get 4.54 or so times 10 to the minus 10th, which is greater than KSP. That tells us that we will get a precipitate. Precipitation will occur. First thing. Yay, precipitation. Now, we can do more than that. We can figure out at equilibrium, how much of everything is there? What are the concentrations of everything in solution? So what we do, because these KSPs are really small numbers, 1.9 times 10 to the minus 10th, that means that the opposite reaction, the K is so big, it essentially just goes to completion. So what we do is we allow the cerium-3 and the iodate to come together and form cerium-3 iodate. Not an equilibrium, just regular reaction. And then once we do that, then we're going to take this and let it unwind, let it dissolve, and then find our equilibrium concentrations. This is how we do these things. So we have to do regular first semester general chemistry stuff here. So we figure out how many millimoles of cerium-3 we have. So we had 840 mils times that molarity. We had this many millimoles. Same thing for the iodate, that many millimoles. Now we have to find the limiting reactant. Remember that? And if we have 6.834 millimoles of iodate, and we can react 1 millimole of cerium-3 for every 3 millimoles of iodate, that's this multimole ratio here, this tells us that we can use up or react with 2.28 millimoles of cerium-3. We have more than that, which tells us that the iodate will run out first. The iodate is the limiting reactant. So at equilibrium, when the reaction is complete, go in this direction, we will have no iodate, but we will have a little bit of cerium-3 left over. Let's go see how much. So if we start with 2.637 millimoles of cerium 3 and we use up what we just figured out, 2.278 millimoles, we're going to have 0.359, 0.36 millimoles of cerium 3 in solution still that didn't combine with iodate. Iodate's going to be all gone, none. So we don't care how much cerium 3 iodate because that's a solid. So now, in order to do our ice table, we're going to calculate our initial concentration of cerium 3. It's just the millimoles over the milliliters. Now remember, we added 840 and 327 milliliters together. So in that solution, there's 167 milliliters. And that gives us about 3.1 times 10 to the minus 4th molar as the initial concentration of cerium 3. Now we can plug into our ice table. See, we went this direction, let this form. Now we're going to let it unwind and see the equilibrium concentrations are. So our initial concentration of cerium 3 we just calculated. Iodate is 0. Set up our ice table, and we get a really interesting looking quartic equation. Don't worry, you won't have to solve these, but I did for you. And I found that X is 1.6 or so times 10 to the minus 3 molar. And so our equilibrium concentration of cerium 3 will be this plus X, which is 1.9 times 10 to the minus 3 molar. And our equilibrium concentration of iodate will be 3X, which is 4.67 times 10 to the minus 3 molar. And what you can do is you can plug these numbers back into our KSP expression and make sure that it equals pretty closely KSP, and it does.